And praise God, there you go. So before we start, let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. Thank you, Lord, for your word being there for us. And Lord, just thank you, Lord, for overcoming so that you can bring us with us, bring us to you with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, at the beginning of our GC voyage, we started all the way back in heaven. And there, we learned this lesson that, see, Lucifer changed the theology of all heaven. The Bible tells us that we look not by sight, but by faith. So what started happening is when he started looking at God, or Jesus himself, he started changing how he saw God. Instead of looking at him as an exalted, eternal God, he started to look at him as something less than that, something that he can attain to be. So this is why this verse in Psalms 50, verse 21, applies to this whole message. If you'd like to go there, this is a very good verse to highlight. God says this in Psalms 50, verse 21. I'm just going to quote it. It says, "These things you have done, and I kept silent. You thought that I was altogether such a one as yourself, but I will reprove thee and set you in order." Now here God, in this context, is letting them know, look, just because I kept silent doesn't mean I'm just like you people. And this is the problem. Sometimes we look at God and we think he's just like us. We think God has our same faults, same limitations, and then we try to look Adam in that way. And this was the problem of Lucifer. He looked at Christ, and then when all the angels bowed and worshiped him, he thought, hold up, how can this guy be God? Look at him. And sometimes, you know, we think that it should be that way, that everything should be the way we see it to be. So just imagine it. Let's say one Sabbath, God just shows up on stage, and he goes, then we see God. And I say, hey, you're God? He says, yeah, I'm God. Oh, well, hey, God. Well, nice seeing you, okay? Then I say, oh, well, God, you know, you're very short. Well, how tall you think I should be? Well, I would think you'd be a little taller. I mean, you are a God. Okay, so then God, he just enlarges himself to 10 feet tall. Is this tall enough? That's still too short. I mean, you're God. Okay, then God enlarges himself to 100 feet tall. God, you're still too short. Then God enlarges himself to 1,000 feet tall. Then you say, well, God, you're still too short. You made planets. Come on. You're supposed to be a little taller than that. Then God enlarges himself to the point where he's bigger than all the planets. And he holds this planet in his finger. And then you look at God and you say, God, you're still too short. You made all the galaxies. And then he says, okay. Then he enlarges himself bigger than the universe. And then you go, God, where are you? I'm bigger than the universe. But I can't see you. Well, you can't see around the universe. Well, if I can't see you, how am I going to believe you? Well, you're going to have to go by faith on this one. That's why the Bible says this. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing of the word of God. It'd be impossible for you to see everything that God has. Even if God had a tail, would you know the end of his tail? Would you be able to follow the end and say, okay, God has a tail? No, it would go on forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. And before you know it, you find yourself as a skeleton and say, hold on, God, I don't believe you now. You have an eternal tail. See, this is the thing. When Jesus came into the scene, when he came on earth, it was very hard for men to even believe that, to even go by faith. And that's the problem with all of us. We don't want to go by faith anymore. We want to go by what we see. We want to go by what we do. And that was the problem with the Jews. They kept on doing things and trying to work on things on their own way, trying to work on salvation. And it just seemed so foolish to even have faith in God. So if you turn with me to Matthew chapter 11, here, at this point, Jesus, the Bible says, I like this word, he upbraided a Capernaum for their lack of faith in him, because he started saying, look, if all the miracles that was done in your city, if it was done in Sodom and Gomorrah, Sodom would still be here. And then it goes on in verse 25, and it says this. At that time, Jesus answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father, neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heaven laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And this is a very powerful verse. Many people don't even realize all the implications of this. Here, he says this. He thanks God for hiding all this truth from the wise and the prudent and giving it to babes. And the reason why that's a very good strategy for God is because, see, children are a lot more simpler than adults. The older we get, the more cynical we get. The more it gets harder and harder for us to believe in simple truths of the Bible. Because of all our experiences, all of our disappointments and our failures, we start to doubt everything. When God says, come on, you can walk on water, we start thinking, is that rational? I don't know. My professor said, this book said, this and that said, you know what happened to my uncle? You know, this is, and we have all these histories and all these things, experiences that we use to doubt God's word. Now, if you tell a child, hey, you can walk on water. Really? Really? And then they would go to them, mommy, he told me you can walk on water. You know, you should see the faces of kids when I tell them, hey, Jesus is coming. He's coming? Really? They believe it, literally, because they don't really have much to doubt. But adults, it gets harder and harder. And can you imagine? You know, Jesus, he's God. He walks on the scene and he tells everybody, look, hey, I'm God. The Pharisees, who were perhaps 50 years old and older, you know, they're thinking, hold on. That don't make sense. We didn't learn this in our schools. This doesn't make sense. And of course, they will continue to bash and then smash everything that Jesus said because of what they learned in school. Because what ends up happening is we become slaves to the ordinary. We start saying, well, we never done that before. That doesn't make sense. I mean, come on. We've been doing this for years, Jesus. No one has just said, there's going to be fish on the right side of the boat. That just doesn't make sense. We never done that before. Or, come on, David. No one takes down a giant with a rock. We never done that before. And we start doing things the old, same old way. We don't want to change. We don't want to hear anything new. So God says, no, let's just give this stuff to babes. Let's give this stuff to little children. You know, because Jesus was about to shed some light. I mean, some strong light. This was the greatest mystery of all time. And this mystery was the Trinity. The fact that God was three, one, and basically one God. Now, how are you going to share that with someone who is too proud to even believe it? So, guess who you went to? Teenagers. the disciples were perhaps just teenagers. There were 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds. The oldest was perhaps 25 years old. And a rabbi had to be 30. Pharisee had to be at least 50. So he had to share this with children. Then he goes on to say this. He says this, which is so cool. How I lost my page. Well, let me just say from memory. He says, no man knows the Son except the Father, and no man knows the Father except the Son, and whoever the Son reveals him to. Now, Jesus says this profound statement to everybody, that Jesus is so deep that it takes only God to know him. Then he also says, look, I know God unlike anyone else. And the only way you can know him is by coming through me. And just like he repeated some other time in John 14, verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. So Jesus says this profound statement about him being God. And a lot of times what the Pharisees would do, they would try to belittle Jesus. They would say, hey, isn't this Jesus of Nazareth Joseph's son, the carpenter? And they would say, oh, this guy ain't that, he ain't nobody. They would try to belittle him. But Jesus, he would say some things that would still startle them. He would just, if you go to John chapter 5, this is what's crazy. John chapter 5, which is going to lead to my first slide. And it says this. John chapter 5, verse 17. This is right after he healed the man on the Sabbath. And the Jews were angry with him. And then Jesus said, he says, my Father work, hitherto I work. Therefore, the Jews sought the more to kill him because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Now, some people look at that and say, what does that mean? My Father work, hitherto I work. Because Jesus basically was saying this. Look, yeah, God created the Sabbath and all that. But if God was to literally stop working, the clouds would stop moving, the rivers would stop flowing, the planets would stop moving, the stars would stop burning, the birds would stop chirping, we would be stuck in motion. I mean, literally, everything would stop moving. Our hearts would stop beating, and we would not be able to taste food. And the reason why God continues to work so that we can continue to enjoy life and rest in his work. That's why we keep the Sabbath. So we can just one day just take a time off and realize, look, man, I don't need to keep working to make this world continue to move. If I just stop working, it doesn't mean the whole world is going to end. God got this. He's actually doing all this for me. So Jesus says this. Look, my Father works, hitherto I work. Just the way he healed the man, just so he can continue to enjoy life, is the same way the Father was doing that for the whole entire universe. And the Jews, they saw that. They said, hey, you're calling God your Father in the way to make yourself equal with God. And then Jesus, he not only saw that they were angry at that, he just made it even worse. He says this. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do, for what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that himself doeth. And he will show him greater works than these, that ye may marvel. For as the Father raises up the dead and quickens them, even so the Son quickens whom he will. So if you find this text a little kind of confusing, if you want to think about it in a certain way, this is how we can look at it. It's a term it divine synchronization. So in other words, when the Father does this, the Son does this, somewhere out in eternity, the Father says, Happy Sabbath. The Son does, Happy Sabbath. When the Son says, take up your bed and walk, the Father says, take up your bed and walk, somewhere out in eternity. If the Father says, rise from the grave, the Son says, rise from the grave. That's whatever the Father does, the Son does also. Then he goes on and he says this, for the Father judges no man. Now, does that make sense? God the Father judges no man? Now, is it because God the Father isn't smart enough? Is it because God the Father isn't strong enough? No. And it says, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He that honors not the Son honors not the Father which has sent him, which is powerful. Now, a lot of people, our Muslim friends, they don't quite read this text. They kind of miss this one. See, it clearly tells us that you have to honor, or in another sense, worship Jesus just as the way you worship God the Father. In other words, equal. Then, notice at the very, very bottom, it says, he that honors not the Son honors not the Father which had what? Sent him. Now, you notice a lot through the Gospels, Jesus will say, I was sent. I was sent unto this time. Or this, I was sent, I was sent, I was sent. Now, he gets this from this profound verse. Now, if you turn with me to Isaiah chapter 48. Now, even Jews find this verse super complex. Isaiah chapter 48. Here, we find God speaking, and then if we start from verse 12, and it says this, hearken unto me, O Jacob and Israel, my called, and I am he, and I am the first, and I am also the last. My hand also hath laid the foundation of the earth. My right hand hath spanned the heavens when I called unto them. They stand together. When I call them, they stand together. All ye assemble yourselves and hear. And among them hath declared, which among these hath declared these things? The Lord hath loved him. He will do pleasures on Babylon, and his arm shall be on the Chaldeans. Then he goes on, verse 15. I have spoken. Yea, I have called them. I have brought him. And he shall make his way prosperous. Now, the next verse is the most powerful verse. Then it goes on. It says, Come ye near unto me. Hear ye this. I have not spoken in secret from the beginning. From the time that it was, there am I. Now the Lord God and his Spirit has sent me. Now, did you just catch that? It says this. We go on. We know that God is the one speaking. He created everything. And as he continues to talk, he says, and now the Lord God and his Spirit has sent me. I don't know if you caught that, the majesty of that verse, but we find God sending himself. So then whenever Jesus says, the Father has sent me, he is talking in terms of God sending himself. And people say, well, where did this come from? Jesus said, God said to himself, I have not spoken in secret. This has always been known from the very beginning in Genesis when God said, let us make man. God wasn't keeping a secret. This is how it was the whole time. So now when Jesus shows up, people are confused. It says, verse, if you go down that lower verse, it says, "For as the Father has life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself, and has given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man." Because. Now, a lot of times people find this kind of confusing. Like, okay, why because he is the Son of Man? Why is the fact that he can judge only because he is the Son of Man? Well, I came up with this graph. I call it the Oval Office. Now, this is what I use to explain the Trinity to even a two-year-old. Now, do you know why I call this the Oval Office? Yeah, because it's the oval. And within that oval, that represents the entire universe, everything, space, time, all that, is the entire universe. And that line, you see, one is pointing that way, which represents eternity past, and the other is pointing forward, which represents eternity future. And you see that part where you see the cross right there? That represents the time when Jesus was here. That line that is kind of wiggling all the way up towards the very top represents the connection that Jesus had with his Father and with God himself. Now, if you look, God the Father is above and beyond the entire universe. If you look, you see God the Son, he's in the universe. And then you look at the Holy Spirit, he is outside the universe, and also in the whole entire universe, all throughout time and all in every place, all at the same time. Now, get this. Now, God the Father, he's above all time. Now imagine this. If God was to speak, and let's say God was to say someone's name, Irma, and he's above all time. Where would his voice end up in time? Where would his voice end up? It would actually end up all throughout time. So no matter where you go, you hear, Irma, 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 and you just hear all throughout time, Irma, 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 Irma. And you're like, God, hold on, stop. Stop speaking. You're speaking all through time. So now God has a dilemma. He has to limit himself. He has to limit himself to one point in time. So you see God the Son walking in time. Just walking. He's going forward in time. And the Holy Spirit is throughout all time. Now, can you hug the Holy Spirit? Can you? Not kind of, in a sense, in a spiritual sense. Or can you crucify the Holy Spirit? I mean, of course not. Can you hold him? No. See, there's a point where God has to limit himself to one place in time so that we can actually interact with him. See, this was the problem. In heaven, when Lucifer and everyone was rebelling against God, and they were saying, the devil was saying to God, see, the problem is your law. You're telling us to keep your laws, and we can't keep it. Why are you telling us to do this and do that? And if we don't do this, we'll go to hell. That's not fair. And then God is showing, look, you can do it. And just like the challenge that he brought to Job, he said, look, to Job, about Job, he says, the only reason why he's actually perfect and he's doing things right is because you bless him. If you took his blessings away from him, he will curse you to the face. Now, he brought that same doubt to all the universe about Jesus. The only reason Jesus is so perfect, is so holy, the only reason why he's so God is because you give him all that power. Take all that power away from him. Yeah. Take his deity. And see, let's see if he will curse you and just break all the commandments just like us. So Jesus, he lived a perfect life in our shoes. Now imagine this. let's say we were playing basketball, and I had a team where I had all the best players in it. I had Michael Jordan at his best. I had Kobe Bryant, all these cool guys on my basketball team. Then there's another team that comes on, and they have this one person named Emmanuel. Now, Emmanuel, he has these sneakers that can cause him to teleport and also rewind time and also just shoot flames whenever he wants. So you guys are playing basketball. Next thing you know, Emmanuel just comes, poof, takes your ball and teleports and starts making points by the zillion. And everyone's like, hold up. This is not fair. Because every time someone tries to do a crossover, Emmanuel just steals it by teleporting or rewinding time to take the ball. And you're like, hold on, this is not fair. How are we going to go against this guy when he's not going by the same laws? He is not going by our rules. That's not fair. That is so not fair. So this is what God did. Jesus, he's like, okay, you think I'm saying all these things for no reason. So he takes off his shoes, takes off his deity, and he walks in our shoes, and he shows us how to follow him. So you click forward, but this can reach. So as we go on, we find that still people, when they read the Bible, they still have these questions, you know. Now people think, man, why are we going through this? Well, you don't realize the danger until the danger actually comes. You know how many churches have fallen apart and young people going to Islam and all these different places because they don't understand who Jesus is. Now they read texts, for example, like John chapter 14, verse 28, where Jesus says, the Father is greater than I. And they say, hold on, how can the Father be greater than Jesus if he's God? Like, that doesn't make sense. Well, if you look at the part where Jesus is below time, now if Jesus is in time and he's limiting himself on purpose, his Father is going to be greater than him in the roles that he plays. So that's why he can still say, I and the Father are one, and at the same time, equal. And if you go to Mark 13, 32, a lot of times Jehovah's Witnesses would use this, or anyone, they would say, hold on, but this verse says, but of that day and the hour knows no man, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, but the Father. They say, hold up, if Jesus is God, how can he not know when he's coming? Shouldn't God know everything? That's a good question. Shouldn't God know? See, this is the thing. When Jesus became man, what he did, he took off his divine knowledge of everything, and he became a man. If you ever heard of that song, you know, what if God was one of us? You know, if he walked around with God knowledge, he still would not be one of us. So what he did, he took off everything. The Bible says he humbled himself in Philippians chapter 2. He humbled himself. In the Greek, it says he emptied himself. So all the stuff that made him God, kind of took it off, laid it off on the side, and just left it there. So that when he was in the wilderness, when the devil tempted him, he says, if you're the Son of God, turn this stone into bread. He didn't do it. Why? Because if he had done it, he would not be representing man. Nobody can say, I'm going to follow Jesus. If Jesus walked on a plane where we couldn't follow him, then it would be a failure. We would not be able to say, oh, well, I'm going to follow Jesus wherever he's going. No, the devil's going to say, hold on. Jesus was cheating. He used a cheat code to pass. So Jesus didn't do that. So he lived just as ignorant as we could be. He didn't have to know. And this is the thing. Like, I can just do this. This is mine. Now, is that still mine? Yeah. I can put it on whenever I want. Now, Jesus, he took off all his eternal knowledge and just left it in heaven. Still walking around. Still, it's still his. He can pick it up whenever he wants. And like Jesus says, I can lay down my life and I can take it up again. Jesus didn't take it up until his sacrifice was accepted. So that's why he did not know. And if you go to Revelation chapter 5, verse 6, it tells us eventually that he does know, because it says in verse 6, it says, "And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth." Now, eyes represents what you see or knowledge, and seven represents perfection or complete. So in other words, he had complete knowledge of everything, and also which are the seven spirits of God. Whatever the Spirit knows, Jesus knew. So yeah, he knows when he's coming. Now other people use this and John chapter 20, verse 17, where Jesus says unto her, unto Mary Magdalene, "Touch me not," or his mother Mary. He says, "For I am not ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and unto your Father and to my God and your God." And some people say, "Hold on, how can he have a God if he's God?" Well, see, the thing is this, since God is three persons, you will find him calling himself God because he needs a witness. Who can be a better witness than God himself? No one. Only God can actually see that he's God. So that's why if you go to Hebrews chapter 1, Hebrews chapter 1, which actually quotes from Psalms 45, Hebrews chapter 1, it says this. It says, "But unto the Son, he saith, Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom." So, Jesus calls the Father God, and the Father calls his Son God, which is very mind-boggling. That's why we find in John 1:1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God," which is so powerful. So if you go on with me to John chapter 14, John chapter 14, we find Jesus, he says these very deep statements. I mean, very deep. John chapter 14. And instead of starting from verse 20, let's start from verse 6. And it says this. Jesus says unto Thomas, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. If you have known me, you shall have known my Father also. From henceforth you know him and have seen him." Verse 8, "Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it will sufficeth us, or be enough for us. And Jesus said unto him, Have I been so long time with you, yet hast thou not known me, Philip? And he that hath seen me has seen the Father. How sayest thou, show us the Father?" All right, stop right there, which is so profound. Notice, when he said, "Show us the Father," guess who starts speaking? He says, "Have I been so long with you that you have not known me? So it's like God the Father just came down and shot right into Jesus' mind and starts speaking from his lips and says, have I been so long with you? You say this all this time? And then he goes on. If you keep going on, Jesus talks about how he will go away. Let's start from verse 16. Let's go from verse 13. And then it says this. And whosoever shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If ye love me, keep my commandments. I pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, the world seeth me no more, but ye see me. Because I live, ye shall live also. Now, when you first read this, you're like, hold on. Jesus, you're going in circles. What in the world are you saying? But when you continue to read, follow his logic, it's like he says, okay, if you ask anything in my name, you will receive it. So it's like this. Whenever you pray, and sometimes I used to wonder this. I'm like, why do we say in Jesus' name? Why after every prayer we say in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name? And I would ask people, no one would explain it. But really, it just basically means in his place or in his stead. So when you're saying, Lord, I pray that you will bless me in Jesus' name, God the Father, he hears you and he blesses you as if you're Jesus, as if you're in the place of him. And then when Jesus speaks in your name, he represents you before the Father. And when the Holy Spirit does things in Jesus' name, the Holy Spirit represents Jesus. So, this is what happened. It's like, he says, the Spirit will come to you. He's saying he's leaving. He says, the Comforter will come to you. Then he says, I will come to you. Then he says, look, the Holy Spirit, the world cannot see him because they don't know him. But you know him. Then he says, the world will not see me, but I will come to you. So I'm like, what's going on? So in other words, he's speaking as if he will come as the Spirit. So this is what Jesus does throughout this whole chapter. First, he talks like a man, then he talks like God. Then he talks man language, then he talks God language. Then he goes back and forth between talking like a God and then talking like a man. This is what Jesus does so that we will realize that whatever he does, he can handle any of our issues. So if we go back to Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, he says this, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. Now this is the powerful thing. Jesus says, come unto me, all you that labor. The reason why he says this is because back then, the Pharisees were making the religion of Christ or religion of God so hard. They started putting all these laws and rules for him, and they started making people do things that they did not have to do. So, for example, all these Sabbath laws, for example, it was forbidden for them to even spit on the floor. Because if you would spit, that would cause germs, and then the germs would be working, and then you'd be breaking the Sabbath. Or if you touched a pole or a metal pole, you'd be breaking the Sabbath because that's working. Can't turn on fire. You can't do all this. You start doing all these things. And then as soon as the Sabbath came, you know, You felt like, oh man, can't even do nothing. And then you got a cold and you sneezed and then you spit. Oh no, broke the Sabbath. Then you're gathering all this guilt. It's like, oh man, I can't. And then you go to church and then people are looking at you and they're making sure that you're not breaking the Sabbath. And then you start playing with your fingers. And then the Pharisees, you should not be doing that. Oh man. Then you're burdened with more guilt and then more judgment. And before you know it, you find yourself saying, man, this religion thing is too hard. I mean, I have so many sins to account for now. So then when Jesus comes on the scene, he says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Or in other words, look, take my way. It's easier. Taking your way of trying to gain salvation is very hard. Now, if you try to live up to some man's expectations, it's going to be very hard. That's going to be a very miserable life. I dare you, try it. Try to live up to somebody's expectations. Do everything they say they want you to do. You're going to die. If you keep trying to please people, you're going to have all this burden, especially your own. And then Jesus says this, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. Now, the thing about God, which is so cool, is that he is humble. Now, a yoke is a thing that, you know, oxen and sometimes goats and just farm animals will wear, and they would have to attach it to the other ox. And as they're walking down the farm, they'll be tittling the dirt so that they can plant plants and, you know, farm the land and make it easier for them to plant. So sometimes their yokes would be so heavy. I mean, if you just put too much work on them, I mean, they would die faster. So Jesus says, look, take my yoke and learn of me. So you start to yoke yourself with Jesus. And, you know, you're yoking yourself. You watch Jesus walk, and, you know, as you're walking with him, you look at how Jesus walked, and you say, okay, that's how you work. And he says, learn of me because I am meek and lowly in heart. Now, that's the good thing. Now, imagine, I don't like working with people who are so proud. You ever try to talk to people who are, like, super proud, and all they do is want to talk about themselves? And, like, when you, like, even when they ask you questions about you, they're only doing it so that they can turn the conversation about themselves. And, I mean, every single thing ends in a conversation about themselves, about everything they do. And before you know it, you just get so annoyed of them. You don't even want to talk to them. You know, they call you, you ignore their calls. And the thing is, the reason why you don't like it is because what they end up doing is they try to make you look lower and lower and lower and lower. And this is how it is. Oh, I see. You, oh, okay. You're this. Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. Yeah, you are cool. You are cool, man. Okay. And you feel so low around them. And they continue to drag you along, and they make you feel very horrible. They make you feel ugly. They make you feel dumb. They make you feel all these things. And then they ask you, so tell me about you. Okay, I see. Yeah, I used to live in New York too. And then just go on and on and on. Sometimes, and that's the thing. A lot of times, we rather be yoked to these people. Not because it makes sense. Because our flesh is foolish. You know, we would love to follow these rappers and follow these celebrities. We love to follow all these people that's all about themselves. But when it comes to Jesus, who he is, when you look at him, the Bible says this, even though he was equal with God, he made no reputation, no reputation of himself being God. Now, that's why when you read the Gospels, you don't find in every chapter him saying, I'm God. Hey, you know I made that Pharisee? Okay. You know I made that dirt? You don't find in Jesus saying that over and over and over. He even though he was God, he just walked around, just talked about trees and plants, and he just talked about simple stuff. He could have done it. He could have bragged about it. And if there's anyone that deserves to brag, it would be Jesus. But notice, he says, I'm low in heart. And also, he says, I am meek, very meek. Look, I appreciate Jesus because he is so patient with me. A meek person knows how to be very patient with you. Because look at this. And I think First Corinthians, it might be second, but we all know the verse. Do not be unequally yoked. Do not. Now, can you imagine yourself being, or an ox being unequally yoked with, let's say, a cat? You know, one of my favorite animals. Can you see that? Like an ox, and you see the cat just hanging, you know, just trying to move. Or let's say you made the yoke, you know, balanced enough, and the cat is walking. You see the cat trying to leave, you know, trying to scratch itself away from the ox, and the ox is like, what are you doing? Let's just keep walking. And the cat is just, no, I want cat food. And it's just lazy. It doesn't want to do anything. It doesn't work. Or let's say you get a ox and a donkey. They might be the same height. Might be. The thing about donkeys, they start kicking. And, you know, you find a donkey, a lot of times they're very stubborn. And you find the ox, and it's just going. This is what life is all about, just walking. And the donkey's like, I don't want to go that way. I want to stop. And it's kicking and kicking the ox and kicking the ox. And you know, even though the Bible says do not be unequally yoked, Jesus is unequally yoked to us. You know that? We are so unequally yoked to Jesus. We cannot even compare to him. So humble. And we're continually kicking against him. And we're walking around. And we're like, Jesus, I don't want to do that. Nah, I don't want to go to that church. Nope, Jesus, I don't want to pray. Nope, not right now. And we keep kicking. Nope, I don't want to read the Bible. Just do the work by yourself, Lord. You don't have to use him. Use him. Mm-mm. And you keep going. And then as you're going, you see, oh, you want us to go through that field? Nah, that's a lot of work. All those children, uh-uh. We ain't going that way. And we continue to kick against Jesus, kick against Jesus. But the thing is this, we're supposed to be yoked. In other words, chained to him. Chained to him. So even when you want to get out, you stay, in other words, married to Jesus Christ. So as time goes on, Jesus might break you. He will break you. And you're watching him. And you're watching him. He's patient. He's loving. He's caring. And you begin to want to walk just like him. And you're like, oh, man. Jesus, I was going to say this to him and her, but when I looked at your face, when I saw you bleeding on that cross, I thought, nah, let me just keep going. And I just keep walking. Jesus, when I saw that you love the demoniac, and I just can't love my own friends and family, and I disrespect them all the time. Nah, I'm not going to do that no more. And you just keep on walking with Jesus. Keep on walking, keep on walking. And eventually, it gets to a point where you want to give up. And Jesus, he has to encourage you. He has to say, no, just come on, just get up. And you're falling. So Jesus, just leave me alone. Jesus says, look, take my yoke, man. It's easy. Look, it's not going to be easier anywhere else. And the reason why it's easier is because Jesus carries your burdens. Jesus carries your sins on his shoulder. Jesus carries your past and he suffers through it. A lot of times, the reason why we give up is because we carry such a heavy burden. We try to drag our past with us. We try to drag our sins and says, you know what? I'm going to work on it myself. I'm going to try to fix it. And eventually, I'm going to work all this field of life, and all my sins is going to be passed away. But we keep building more and more burdens for ourselves. And Jesus says, look, just take my yoke. Just take it. Just believe the promises of the word. It's just that simple. And as we go on in life and go on, we begin to watch Jesus as he carries that cross. And as he carries that cross, we see him hanging on that cross. And there we see that Jesus loved his neighbor as himself. That is the thing about God. He keeps all his commandments, all of it. And loving your neighbor as himself, that's what he did. God, he didn't love us as a cat or a dog or an animal. He loved us as himself. So he treated us as if we were on the same level with him. But we're not. We are so much lower than him. But he loves us still. This is why he says, take my yoke and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. And when you realize that, you shall find rest unto your souls. So that's why when I started off in Psalms 50, verse 21, he says, look, you thought that I was altogether such a one as yourself, but I will reprove you and set you in order. You got to remember this, because when you find yourself on the floor, when you find yourself guilty and wanting to give up, and you think God is going to give up on you, remember, look, God ain't like you. He is not like you. In other words, he's not going to give up on you like you would. He's not going to give up on you like the person, I don't know, your wife or your husband, he's not going to give up on you. God actually makes it clear in Isaiah, I believe 49, verse 16. Look, can the mother, you know, forget the child of her womb? Yea, they may forget, but I will not forget. So it's very possible that the person who should love you the most here on earth will neglect you. But he says, look, don't look at me that way. I'm not like them. I will never forget you. I will always remember that you're there. That's why he sets you as valuable as himself. So as we continue to look at this GC voyage, when you realize, man, it's very important for us to realize that Jesus is God in the fullest sense. When you realize that, You can know that him carrying your burdens will actually save you. And you will continue to walk with him. And because he is with you, like he says, like Adam says to his wife, you know, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, Jesus can say the same thing to us, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. And he can also say to God, God from eternity. And we all can be united with God or be one with him. Now, if it's your desire to be one with God, to be yoked with Jesus Christ, so that your burdens will be light, I want you to raise your hand. Not only raise your hand, I want you to stand up. Yeah, don't stand up, because sometimes we walk in life and we pretend that everything is so hard. And it is. It is hard. But the word tells us this, these light afflictions worketh for us a more eternal weight of glory. So when Jesus is the center of your soul, center of your life, you will realize that everything will be lighter because he is carrying your burdens. Now my friend right here, Gianluca, he's going to play Jesus, the center of my soul. Or my life. And as we think about that, let us remember that Jesus is carrying us with his yoke. Thank you. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you, Lord Jesus, for loving us so much, Lord. Taking us, Lord, within your yoke, Lord, even though we're not equal, Lord. You see us as if we're equal. But, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for cherishing us as if we're friends, but we can be. So, Lord, I ask that you would, Lord, those who are making decisions, Lord, to take that step, Lord, to be yoked to you, get baptized, be changed forever, and walk forever with you in this, I would say, this field of eternity. I pray that you would continue to call them, Lord, as you said to those 2,000 years ago, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest unto your souls. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.